How are you doing?
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome everyone to our hour of worship this morning, whether in person or online. We welcome everyone on this beautiful winter day, and I think what Friday or something is the first Thursday or Friday would be the 1st of March, so it's all downhill after that. I didn't put the snow blower away though. Just in case. Just to highlight a couple announcements, no Bible study this Monday night. Tuesday night is 7 o'clock trustee meeting. And Saturday morning, Lenten breakfast will be at Messiah Church in Shippensburg. And if you forgot to order Easter flowers, there are still forms in the lobby, so Lieutenant's shaking her head, yes. So anyone, you still have time till next week, yes. So I think you have 5 weeks till Easter, but she needs the orders in by in the next week. So, anyone else have any announcements? No? Okay, let's continue our service. You all please rise for the Latin travelers, who is this Jesus that we follow?
He is the Messiah.
What kind of Messiah is Jesus?
He is the Messiah who teaches that he will lose his life and who calls us to lose our lives in order to save our lives.
How does it feel to follow a Messiah whose teachings and call are so hard and uncomfortable?
Some feel fear and anger, while others feel uncertain and anxious, and still others feel resolute and ready to follow.
Latin travelers, we are not alone in our feelings about following Jesus as our Messiah. It is a hard road. The blessing is that we do not travel it alone.
Thanks be to God that we share this journey with Jesus and one another as we lose our lives for the sake of the gospel, to save our lives through Jesus, our Messiah. Amen.
Let's continue our service with the first verse of How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Holy God, Open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. So we often hear people ask questions like this: why do bad things happen to good people? Or if God is so good and so loving and so kind, why does God allow people to suffer? How should a Christian respond to suffering? If God is all-powerful, then why was the crucifixion of Jesus even necessary? Those are the kinds of questions we ponder during Lent or any time we experience tragedy, illness, loss, or heartache. And these kinds of questions are asked by both believers and non-believers. Many of us ask God, why? Or why me? If God is good, how do we explain suffering? How do we respond in a Christian way? Well, first we need to start with, being a Christian doesn't mean we're promised an easy life, right? The Bible's not a book of placating platitudes. If anything, the Bible's in many ways the exact opposite. John 16:33 says this: in this life, you will have trouble. And in Matthew 10:16, Jesus tells his disciples that he's sending them out like sheep among wolves. That includes all of us. We call ourselves disciples. But sheep among wolves, that doesn't sound like an easy or carefree life, does it? So the truth is, we all experience suffering. We all experience loss. So why do bad things happen to good people? Because bad things happen to everyone. None of us is immune to the hurt and pain of this broken, hurting world. So we can't always answer the question of why God allows suffering. But I think it's normal for us to want to try to find a reason. We sometimes want to blame someone or something. Or maybe we blame ourselves. Or maybe we even blame God. That's normal. But let's think for a minute about the story of Job. I always come back to Job when we talk about suffering, because he suffered all kinds of tragedies. And his friends, they tried to come up with logical explanations for why. But Job had done nothing wrong. And God was not trying to punish him. But still, God allowed Job to suffer. So I think we can never assume that our hardships are caused by God or that God is trying to punish us. We may never know why God allows suffering. So we must take it on faith that in the end, God will make all things right, and that our pain can and will be redeemed by God. One thing we can say for sure, though, is that Jesus suffered. As we continue our study on the Apostles' Creed, we focus today on lines 6 and 7, which say this: suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. In those two short lines, we see the most dramatic example of Jesus' suffering, which was on the cross. The crucifixion event reminds and reassures us that God understands human suffering intimately. But if God is good, why was the crucifixion even necessary? You know, it's hard to know God's exact reasons, and we could discuss it for hours, but the Bible tells us the crucifixion was God's plan from the very beginning to save humanity and to restore a right relationship with the Creator and the creation. The crucifixion was no accident. We can't blame anyone or use it as an excuse for anti-Semitism. And while we can argue why or why not it was necessary, that's not really the point. The point is that God would hold nothing back in order to offer us salvation. Now, there are a few other examples of Jesus suffering in the New Testament. In the Gospel according to John, we hear a pivotal story about the death and resurrection of Jesus' beloved friend, Lazarus. This is a story about love, compassion, disappointment, loss, and resurrection. And this story contains the shortest verse of the whole Bible, which is only two words. Do you know what that is? Jesus wept. You guys are good. So the story of Lazarus' death and resurrection doesn't appear in the other three Gospels. It's only in the Gospel of John. And according to John, this is the final climactic sign before the crucifixion. It's the direct cause of Jesus' arrest, according to John. Which gives greater meaning to what John says in 15:13, saying, "No one has greater love than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friends." Now, before we unpack this story a little bit further, we have to understand some of the Hebrew customs surrounding death and suffering. The laments of the people are recorded in Psalms and Lamentations, and also in the individual narratives of the patriarchs. And in those stories, we read that 30 days is described as the normative period for mourning following the death of Moses and his brother Aaron. Some of the other biblical customs include visible and audible signs of mourning, including wailing, wearing sackcloth, pouring ashes on one's head, and even hiring professional mourners. Did you know that was a profession? Did you know you could hire professional mourners? I've never hired one. I don't know. In this shortest verse of the Bible, Jesus wept, we see Jesus' humanity. We see that Jesus loved Lazarus, and he joins in the grief and the customs of grieving of his community. There's a long-standing tradition of lament in this community, and Jesus would have been expected to mourn and lament the way that everyone else did. And Jesus' laments signify, in this story, divine participation in human suffering. And it serves as the model for what humans should do when they face grief. What's the Christian thing to do in the face of suffering? Well, if Jesus is our example, then the Christian thing to do is to cry and lament. If we never give ourselves permission to cry, then we impede our healing process. If we bottle up our emotions over time, those bad feelings don't go away. They only fester and cause us more pain. So the tears of the Old Testament patriarchs and Jesus' own public display of grief at the grave of Lazarus confirm that weeping is a godly response to suffering. It shows our humanity, our love, our longing, and confirms our hope in the resurrection. The story of the resurrection of Lazarus paints a picture of Christ as a fellow sufferer who understands human emotions intimately. Jesus shares the grief of Mary and Martha and joins them in their tears, showing them compassion. Now, Mary and Martha, they both had complete faith and trust in Jesus, but still, they were not immune to grief. Similarly, we who have faith and trust in Jesus cannot expect to avoid grief in our lives. It's a normal part of life. In this story, we can ask several questions about why Jesus weeps. Think about it. He already knew that he could restore Lazarus, so why didn't he just do it immediately? Why did he take the time to weep? Well, one commentator, author John Gossip, writes this. He said, "These tears are an authentic revelation of the divine, granting us insight into God's mind and nature, bringing home to us some inkling of the wonder of his compassion, of the depth and sureness of his sympathy with his needy, desperate world, and for hurt minds and hearts." Another commentator, Sir Oliver Lodge, writes this, "A God that could understand, that could suffer, that could sympathize, that had felt the extremity of human anguish, the agony of bereavement, this is the extraordinary conception of the Godhead to which we have thus far risen." So Jesus weeps because he has total empathy for those who suffer. His weeping in this story doesn't show anger, indignation, or weakness. Rather, it shows the Son of God as someone who loved deeply and who mourned deeply. It shows us that the greater we love someone, the greater our own grief will be when we lose them. Grief and love are two sides of the same coin. To love is to suffer. But that doesn't mean we should avoid love, does it? Just because we know we'll suffer someday. We're still called to love. The next question about this story that comes to mind is, why didn't Jesus travel to Bethany the moment he learned of Lazarus' illness? I mean, wouldn't it have been easier for him to just come right away and just prevent the death in the first place? I mean, that's what Mary and Martha ask him. Why does Jesus delay his arrival and allow Mary and Martha to suffer if he loved them so much? Well, there are a few different possibilities to consider. First, Jesus, I think, allows Mary and Martha to feel the full weight of death and grief before he performs this miracle. And perhaps it's because there is some hidden value in suffering. I believe that we and the disciples must eventually come to a place where we feel the full weight of Jesus' death on the cross before we can fully appreciate his resurrection. I think too often during Lent we want to skip over the dark parts. We want to go straight to Easter. But there's value in contemplating suffering, death, and mortality, both for Jesus and for ourselves. And sometimes it's only in our own human suffering that we can really appreciate the suffering and sacrifice of Jesus. Similarly, I believe that during Lent, we are meant to feel the full weight of our own sin before we come to repentance. We can't come to a place of true repentance if we never fully acknowledge the depth of our own sinful natures. The last question I have about this story is, why is there the comment about Jesus' love for Lazarus? It says this: see how he loved him? I think this statement reveals much about the nature of God. First, we know that Jesus' love for Lazarus, Mary, and Martha was deep and intimate. And so this is the same kind of relationship we're all meant to have with God, something deep and intimate. Second, I think this statement alludes to the fact that Jesus' love for his friends will ultimately lead to his own arrest and crucifixion. Jesus gave himself up for his friend Lazarus. The Gospel of John claims that this is the direct cause of Jesus' arrest. Likewise, Jesus also gave himself up for all of humanity when he allowed himself to be lifted up on the cross. One commentator writes, "Sacrificial love enables communion and perfect knowledge between the one who gives up his or her life and the one for whom the sacrifice was made." So through Jesus' sacrificial love, we come into a closer, more intimate relationship with God. Thirdly, I think this revelation of love through tears is the kind of love that we are meant to emulate with each other. Jesus is teaching us that it's okay to cry when we lose someone we love. And Jesus is modeling what godly lament looks like. Today's scripture reading included a short lament, and I think we sometimes forget there is an entire book of the Bible dedicated to lamentations. And if lamenting is so important that there's a whole book in the Bible dedicated to it, then shouldn't we view lamenting as an important Christian practice? Now, by lamenting, I don't mean being in a constant state of melancholy or hopelessness or criticizing or complaining. Instead, a biblical lament is, in essence, a prayer. The purpose is not simply to give voice to pain, not simply to be heard by others or even the divine, but to bring about a change that will lessen or ease our suffering. A lament does not show weakness. It shows that we have faith in a God who hears us and who answers our prayers. It shows that we have faith in a God who is big enough to handle our worst emotions. And if you read through the Book of Lamentations, you'll notice that most of the sections, they start out sad or angry or with feelings of helplessness or hopelessness. But by the end, there's a transformation, there's a change, and they end up showing great hope in the faithfulness of God. The same pattern is seen in the Psalms. When you read through them, they start out angry or sad, and by the end, they show tremendous faith. As Christians, we are called to cry out to God. We're expected to weep and lament. And when we see others suffering, we respond with empathy and caring. When we weep with those who weep, we bear one another's burdens and bring them comfort. You know, even tiny babies understand this principle. If you've ever volunteered in a church or a nursery or spent any time in a daycare, you know that when one baby starts crying, they all start crying, even if they don't know why. And that's not a sign of weakness or abnormality. It's a sign of healthy, innate human empathy. Now, for some people, especially us introverts, we work really hard at hiding our grief. Now, I don't know about you, maybe it's just me. Some of us are afraid of crying in public, or even crying in front of our own spouse. We don't want to appear weak or overly dramatic. And our self-sufficient American culture teaches us to suck it up and pull ourselves up by our bootstraps. In our country, most people are only given 3 days for bereavement leave, maybe only one day if it's not a close relative. And I often wonder what ever happened to that 30-day period of mourning that was expected in the Old Testament. I wonder how that would change how we grieve. You know, in this story, we see Jesus giving us permission to cry in public, to mourn appropriately and to lean into our grief instead of pushing it away. Because mourning and crying are healthy biblical practices. They don't indicate weakness or doubt in God. On the contrary, it could be a bold prayer out of reverence for God, with a confidence that God is a God of steadfast love and a God who makes and keeps his promises. You know, sometimes just intellectual knowledge of salvation is not enough for followers of Christ in times of suffering, because we need that heart knowledge about Jesus. And the Gospel of John and the story of Lazarus shows us that heart knowledge. And also, the Gospel of John shows us later in its description of the Holy Spirit as the paraclete, the advocate, the comforter. You see, Jesus comforting Mary and Martha is actually a foretaste of the Holy Spirit who will bring them comfort upon Jesus' death. The very thought of Jesus returning breath into Lazarus' lungs alludes to the coming of the Holy Spirit, who is the very breath. I think that to know that God also suffers when we suffer brings comfort. It brings comfort in a way that no other form of comfort can. Christ sees us. Christ knows our suffering. Christ right along with us. Grief is tough. It comes and goes, sometimes without any warning or precognition. We can't just simply decide to let go of it. It's not how it works. It comes and goes unbidden. We can't just lay our grief at the feet of Jesus and expect him to take away like he takes away our sins. It's not the same. But instead, Christ offers to join us where we are and meets us in our sadness and offers his shoulder to cry on. Many of us have lost loved ones in the past year or two, or maybe it's been longer than that. What comfort comes to mind for me this time of year is that we're approaching the second year anniversary of losing my beloved friend and mentor, Pastor Peggy Spangler. And I'm reminded that the anniversary of a death often causes us renewed feelings of grief, even if we don't realize it's the anniversary. So that's normal. Don't be surprised if that happens to you on an anniversary. You know, as I look back on the first few weeks after losing my friend, I remember being surprised at the intensity of my grief. And then a couple of weeks after losing my friend, we celebrated Easter. And it was on that first Easter that I suddenly had this newfound understanding of perhaps what the disciples must have felt after losing their friend and teacher. That first year, I actually felt what I imagined the disciples felt, only I imagined their pain must have been 10 times worse than mine. And I couldn't bear the thought of that much suffering. But that's the very kind of grief we should contemplate and remember during Lent. Those of us who've experienced deep grief know what the disciples must have felt on Good Friday. And Lent is the time to recall our own times of grief, as well as to remember the suffering and death of Jesus. Traditionally, this is done in great detail on Good Friday or perhaps on Palm Sunday, but we also recall Jesus' suffering every time we recite the Apostles' Creed. When we say this together, it shows that as a church, we are willing to share in one another's suffering. We are willing to bear one another's burdens and weep with those who weep. Remembrance, mourning, and lamentation are important Christian practices. They remind us that suffering is real and that it happens to everyone. And that it's hard work to grieve well. Yes, God allows suffering, but God also promises to be with us in that suffering. Psalm 34:18 says, "The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit." So if you are suffering in any way, if you are grieving in pain or suffering any kind of loss, or are crushed in spirit, God is with you. God is close to you, even if you can't feel God's presence. And remember also these words of Jesus from John 16:33. "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble. But take heart, I have overcome the world." Let us pray. Lord God, it is not always easy to think about suffering as normal. We Americans value the pursuit of happiness to the point of forgetting what it says in your word. But we know your values are different from the world's values. So help us to seek you first. Help us to remember that there's no sorrow beyond your understanding. Allow us to feel your presence in our times of trouble and fill us with renewed hope that in the end, all will be made well. Lord, we love you and we trust you and we give thanks for what you're already doing, for what you've done in the past and for what you will do in the future. Bless us and keep us in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us stand and sing together our hymn of response, "It Is Well With My Soul."
Thank you.
not, then let us pray. Lord Jesus, we need you. Every hour we need you. This life is difficult, and without you, there is little hope. So we call upon your name, Jesus. We trust in your goodness and grace. And we come boldly into God's throne room with prayers of intercession. We pray today for Robert, for Larry, for Cindy, for Gan, for Roger, for Tom, for Joyce, and Gail, and Karen. We ask for healing, for comfort, and for hope. And hear us now, Lord, as we lift up those silent prayers, which are heavy on our hearts. Holy Lord, during this season of Lent, you invite us to die to ourselves so that we might find ourselves anew. I pray that we would not be too full of to-do lists and deadlines and anxieties during this season. Lord, help us to leave space for you to do your work of transformation in us. Grant the grace to welcome your Spirit's work, to mortify our flesh, and to breathe the renewing life of Jesus into us. Allow us to participate in his sufferings and to know the power of his resurrection during this 40-day pilgrimage. And be with us now as we pray together the words Jesus taught his disciples, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Let us continue in our worship as we share in our tithes and offerings. The ushers, please come forward.
Thank you. power of the triune God to meet your neighbors and yourself with an open heart as we take up our crosses and follow Jesus.